you said you guys got involved, 48 Hours got involved in 2001 in this case. Take us through how that happened.
We have we look through local newspapers and local news reports looking for stories that have some significance for the justice system. I mean, we don't just do any old case. I mean, we want to do a case that has a lesson to be learned or whatever. And this one, because of the unique kind of evidence, attracted our attention. I mean, originally it was 11 eyewitnesses versus 8 drops of blood that attracted our interest. We had no idea, of course, that we'd be sitting here all these years later on our third trial, still trying to get a verdict that would be sustained by an appellate court.
Now, this third trial, you haven't sat in every single day, but you've been here for a substantial portion of it. What stood out to you?
Well, unquestionably, it was Charles Bonnet. Ever since he entered this case before the second trial, everybody has been wanting to see him in the same courtroom with David Camm. Recall, he and Camm were tried separately way back when. This is the first time that he's been in the courtroom face-to-face with David Camm, and that makes a lot of difference.
And what was your impression of that? I remember the stare down.
Yeah, the stare down was clearly the highlight of it, but to see him, you know, Bonnet, here's the thing about him. He is a very smart, cunning guy. And to see him under cross-examination, I thought was pretty interesting. But the stare down, I mean, just in terms of pure drama, you can't beat those. Well, actually, remember, there were two stare downs. You can't beat that.
Now, you've sat through the deliberations as well. What do you think? Any inkling at all about this time?
Well, I will tell you, in the interest of full disclosure and honesty, that I am always wrong when I try to predict juries. I will say, in my own defense, I'm not the only person who's always wrong. You really can't predict a jury. You have a little better chance in states like Indiana, where they can ask questions. You kind of know what they're interested in. But, you know, really and truly, your guess is as good as mine, unless your guess is the same as mine, in which case we'll both be wrong.
Do you think it's significant at all that the jury asked more than twice as many questions during the state's case compared to the defense?
You know, who knows what that means? It's like, you know, you can read anything you want into that. I think the one thing it does show is that these guys are paying very close attention. I mean, some of those questions were very detailed. Some were very technical. I thought the questions to Charles Bonnet were fascinating. But in terms of reading stuff into it, I'm telling you, there's so many variables. I mean, consider it. There's like 18 people who are between the juries and the alternates. Mm-hmm. So there's all those dynamics. All people have different interests. People key on different things. I'm not sure that there's any way to reliably predict what the questions mean unless they all, you know, seem directed in one area, in one direction, and they weren't.
What about your interactions with David Camm? How many times have you interviewed him now?
I have interviewed him once, I believe three times, and we've spoken on several occasions, and we've had exchanges of letters over the years. He's very consistent in denying his guilt and in asserting his innocence. And very passionate about it. What does that mean? You know, you be the judge. I mean, he's either desperately trying to get his story out, or he's been lying all these years. But I will say he's been very consistent in his denials. And he's an interesting guy to talk to.
What's your feeling as well as, besides talking to Camm and his family, talking to the Wrens? These were two families that knew each other for years and years.
And here's what was really interesting. Way back when, during the first trial, for a few days before, but actually it was before the trial, but for a few days after the murders, the Wrens supported David Camm because they couldn't imagine that he had done this. And then the police came and told them things, and that changed their mind. But, you know, here's the thing about it. The Wrens I've been doing this a long time. I've met a lot of people on both sides of these types of cases. I have never met a group of more genuine people, just good people, than Frank and Janice Wren and their family and their friends. They have been cordial to us under the most difficult circumstances for all these years. So I have a lot of respect for them. I really, I have to say the same for Cam's family, though, too. I mean, you know, we come into these people's lives at the worst possible time, right? And I have seen so many examples of graciousness and eloquence under enormous pressure on both sides of this case. And that's one of the nice things about it.
I think we in the local media have seen that as well with them, especially being here for the past 9-10 weeks.
Right. And you know, Frank Wren has been here every single day, and he's had family problems down in New Albany, and he's still come here every single day. Sat through painful testimony, had to avert his eyes, as you've noticed, I'm sure, when the more gruesome pictures are shown. And, you know, remember, this is the third time he's done this, so imagine the kind of pressure that he's been under.
Is there anything else you want to add? Your thoughts?
Yes, I would like to go back to Connecticut and perhaps have a cocktail.
Yes, I would as well.
Okay, fine. I'll if you get me out of here, Marissa, I'll buy.
Victor, do you have anything you want to add?
No, I
want
to go to Connecticut, though.
Okay, fine. Are you from Connecticut, too?
No, but I'll go.
Okay, fine.
You're all welcome.
Well, then you're buying, because you're the boss.
That's right. I'll be the boss.
We'll make Victor pay, even better.
Sounds good.
Okay?
Yeah, I think
was that any good?
That was perfect.
Good. It's always fun to do these things. It's always weird being...